I think we're good. Okay. Again, God's word for the church, the healing for the woman, and an acknowledgement of what God can indeed do for us from the first century to the 21st century. Okay. This microphone keeps me at a distance. It's kind of weird, and like so that I'm like, anyway. Okay, let me. I had my Bible open until I had to close it and hold it up. Okay, so do you know the science behind touch? Consensual, good, appropriate touch. I just want to be clear about that. Now, there is a wide range of benefits from touch. Consensual, good, appropriate touch. Human touch, it touches a nerve. It touches the vagus nerve, to be exact. It causes your heart rate to go down, your blood pressure to lower, your stress hormone levels to fall. Human touch has been found to strengthen your immune system. One study showed that massage therapy it boosted natural killer cells, cells which attack bacteria and viruses and cancer. Human touch, consensual, good, appropriate touch, makes a person more resistant to pain. It also boosts oxytocin, not oxycodone, oxytocin, which is responsible for those warm, fuzzy feelings. It also induces calm, can improve your mood, reduce stress, anxiety, and depression, and it's good, human, consensual, good, appropriate touch. It is good for our general well-being, and it indeed, it helps with loneliness and isolation and sleep. Human touch sounds pretty much like a necessity. Fast forward, it was Friday, March 13th, 2020, when it was announced that schools were going to close for 2 weeks, starting Monday, March 16th. And thus, the pandemic began. Now, what I am getting ready to say is not intended to be politically charged. It's just my observations from the last 23 weeks. Get it? I'm not making a political statement. Okay, so, all right, 2 weeks, and this will all be over. We'll go back to normal. Don't worry about masks. They're not helpful. 3 weeks later, then, masks are required. And then you have to wipe down your groceries, leave them out in the garage, and let your mail sit on the counter for a week. Like, what good is Amazon Prime if you have to let it sit for a week? And I'm like, I would never eat if I had to wait for food for a week. But anyway, and do not leave your home unless absolutely necessary. Define necessary. Anyway, and stay away from people who are not a part of your household, who do not live in the same walls as you. Socially distance yourself from anyone else. And that has driven me crazy. It's not socially distancing. We're still being social. It's physically distancing ourselves from others. 6 feet. Now I've determined we are a pretty bad judge of what 6 feet actually is. My father and my brothers are 6'2". And we're not, I can't stretch him out between us most of the time. We're always about a good 4 feet from one another, but we'll call it good. Arrows in the grocery store tell you which way to go if you're looking down at the floor. Also, then they've got all the X's about where you're, and those are not 6 feet apart either. But anyway, X's where you're supposed to stand, also, that plexiglass that separates you from the cashier, from the pharmacist, and so you have to shout, and they're trying to listen. Everybody's wearing a mask. It was crazy. You get to visit your doctors over the internet, as if they could know that you are sick. See the color, and anyway, I don't know. So, and then there is no hugging. It's okay if you want to bump elbows, but think about that, folks. Aren't you told to cough into your elbow and sneeze into your elbow? So let's go bump. No way. There was a grandfather. I read a story. A grandfather that went. I knew that this was like. Sorry. That I don't know. I was struggling with that right there. Let me clip it on. I have a myriad of things up here. Okay, that's tacky looking, but nonetheless. So there was a grandfather, and he built this like hugging outfit hung from the clothesline. They lived close to their daughter and their grandkids, and they were so sad that they couldn't hug. And so you stick your hand in the plastic, and then you have to wash it. Sounded like a big hassle to me, but nonetheless. But I got to thinking. Some of y'all have heard this from me. Think about actually when you hug. And we're talking about how human touch, right, increases our immunity and relieves our stress and helps us from isolation, but no hugging. Don't meet with anybody outside your walls. We've gotten a little bit further. Bump nasty elbows. But if you think about it, when you hug, my head is behind yours and your head is behind mine. So we're not breathing on one another. In fact, I think it's safer than talking to one another. You both have masks on, and you can hold your breath. Okay, so let's bump germy elbows. But no hugging. Do not touch anyone. Lord, in your mercy, when's the last time someone consensually, appropriately touched me? That was early on. It was like, oh my gosh, this is ridiculous. Now, folks, some of y'all dropping stuff off at my door, my chocolate and potato chips, Margaret, but nonetheless, I get a text saying, oh, something's at your door. I'm like, ah. But anyway, stay away. No touching. Hand sanitizer, disinfectant wipes, wash your hands 20 seconds. I've said the Lord's Prayer a lot. The Lord's Prayer takes 20 seconds. The first verse of Amazing Grace, Jesus loves me, my God is so mighty, 20 seconds. So socially distance yourself. Stay away. Don't even look at me, you asymptomatic COVID-19 carrying germ. Hand sanitizer, 20 seconds of soap and water. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And you know, my knuckles got to where they hurt from washing my hands so much. No hugging, do not touch. I'm glad we've moved a little bit further from that. But then Camden, he sneaks up beside me and he goes to put his arm around me. Now, first I was like, oh, you can't, what? He's five, an asymptomatic COVID-19 carrying germ. He's a five-year-old boy who loves dinosaurs. And then he's not a germ. He is fearfully and wonderfully made, a masterpiece created by God for good works in Christ Jesus. He's not a germ. And Riley, she wants to swing with me and learn how to draw butterflies. They're kind of fat butterflies, but she's getting it. And Nathan, he's four, and he's beating us all at the game of Sorry, his first time ever playing it. Okay, so he coughed into my elbow. I called time out and washed my hands from fingertips to shoulders, but nonetheless. Then there's Ella. I taught her a card trick, and Miss Mandy is still trying to figure it out. Jake, he's Jake, but he wanted to be tucked in as snug as a bug in a rug. I wore a mask, I hand sanitizer, washed my hands from fingers to elbows. These are people, not asymptomatic or symptomatic COVID-19 carrying germs. Well, they could be those things, but they're people. And touch is healing. And in that, those people reminded me that we need one another. We need one another's consensual, good, appropriate touch. We need to know that we are loved by someone other than the people who are supposed to love us. We need to be noticed, to be seen, and to be heard. A virus which is highly contagious, a virus which can make you sick with various symptoms and varying degrees, a virus which can be deadly, a virus, COVID-19 to be exact, 23 weeks ago, it created a world in which we seem to lose the ability to see one another, to hear one another, to notice one another, to be with one another, and to touch one another, to provide that necessary, consensual, good, appropriate, healing touch. I'm not telling us to not be safe. I hope y'all hear that. But 23 weeks. So imagine 624 weeks without human contact. 27 times longer than what we've already experienced. And well, the no human contact for us was just confined to our immediate household at first. And we've all managed to extend our immediate household. My brothers and sisters in Christ, yay! But with that, 624 weeks without any human touch, any consensual, good, appropriate, healing human touch. If you haven't done the math, that's 12 years. Sheila shared that when she read. 12 years of being sick, 12 years of suffering, 12 years bleeding constantly, so bogged down with all the laundry that entails. And guess what? No washers and dryers during that time. and water not running from faucets, it's not easy. And so she also had to deal with the additional work. She had to deal with being unclean, ceremonially unclean, unclean. 10 to 14 days of quarantine wouldn't clear her for re-entry into society. No. Unclean, unclean. 624 weeks with no human touch. And everyone looking at her with disdain. She is a woman who is unclean. Unclean by something she cannot control. She's a woman who is unclean, who will transmit her uncleanness to anyone who happens to touch her, to anyone who happens to even sit where she has sat. Now, mind you, they're only unclean till that night and that they go through a purification ritual. But she is unclean for as long as she is bleeding. 624 weeks, 12 years. Economically broke, physically distanced, emotionally distanced, spiritually distanced. She wasn't even allowed in the temple. She wasn't even allowed in church. Not with a mask, not 6 feet apart. Nothing. Nada. Zilch. Well, actually, she did encounter some touch in that 624 weeks. I don't know if you heard Sheila Reed, that there was the abusive touch of doctors who only drained her bank account and didn't help heal her, leaving her worse off than she was before and hopeless. Just in case you hadn't heard, human appropriate consensual touch is healing. And she had none of that for 624 weeks. And I've been complaining really about 23 weeks where I have managed some human contact. Even hugging a nephew, but my brother like put his hands over his ears and was like, I don't want to hear it. So, well, whatever. So, this woman that I am speaking of, Sheila, read about her in the Gospel of Mark, unnamed. But her story is actually in all three of the synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's an important story. So we're going to get to it in its fullness, but I want to stop and pray. That prayer is an important part of worship and life. Let us pray. Merciful, mighty, and compassionate God, we come to you this day, maybe a little soggy, maybe a little worried about water in the basement, and still worried about COVID-19 and all of its implications, far-reaching as they are. Settle us into your presence. Remove the distractions so we might be able to focus on your word. Holy Spirit, invade those spaces where we have gathered, making your presence known. Move in power. Lord, I need you to speak in me and to me as you speak in and to your people. Give me your words to convey your message of healing and hope. Speak through me or in spite of me. Let me get out of the way, and may my words and our thoughts be acceptable in your sight. For you are the great physician, our redeemer, and our rock. In Jesus' precious and powerful name, I pray, believing. Amen. So be it. Now, last week, we talked about the demoniac. Well, Jesus was run out of that Gentile territory after having sent a legion of demons into a herd of pigs that ran off a cliff. And so they didn't want anything to do with him. So he got in a boat. He went back across to the other side of the lake. And there was a crowd awaiting him there. No rest for the weary. It's no wonder he fell asleep in the back of the boat even when a storm was raging. But making his way through the crowd was a prominent man, a Jewish leader from the local synagogue, you know, one of those pillars of the church. And those folks were the ones that were normally making trouble for Jesus. I wonder if Jesus sort of, steadied himself, like, okay, like, what am I going to deal with this time? But instead of challenging Jesus, this one threw himself at Jesus' feet and begged for Jesus to come with him so that he might heal his 12-year-old daughter. She's knocking on death's door. He's desperate. And so without hesitation, just as Jesus was going to the centurion's home, Jesus goes with this man, followed by his disciples and that huge crowd pressing in on him. There was somebody else making their way through the crowd. It's that woman, the woman who had gone 624 weeks without appropriate, good, consensual, healing touch, human touch. 12 years, the same length of that leader's daughter, the same years that she had been alive. This woman, though, instead of being a prominent leader in the synagogue, she's not even allowed in the synagogue. She's unclean. Whomever she touches will also be unclean. They're going to have to go through a purification ritual. She shouldn't even be in the crowd. But she's heard about Jesus, and he is her last and only hope. Now, she doesn't throw herself at the feet of Jesus begging. Instead, she approaches him from behind. It's sort of like a sneak attack. And crouching down low to touch the hem of his robe. If only I can touch the hem of his robe, then I will be healed. The Greek here indicates her desire is not just to be healed physically, but to be, but for wholeness and restoration, just as the demoniac was. If only. Desperate. So desperate. She's willing to take that risk. She's willing to put herself in the midst of a crowd that may very well rebuke her, but more than that, make sure that she knows that she's not welcome. Desperate, willing to take a risk for healing and for wholeness. So she manages to reach the hem of Jesus' garment. Undetected, they're probably all just excited to be going to this Jewish synagogue leader's house. Instantly and immediately, her sickness, her physical illness was gone. Gone. No band-aids, no stitches needed to stop the bleeding. No more hemorrhaging, no more flow of blood. According to Levitical law, though, she still had 7 days of being unclean. But then she would be able to go back to worship. She would be able to re-enter civilization, to re-enter her community, to hug her nieces and nephews, to hug those that were her friends until they couldn't be, those who were her friends before she got sick, before she was ostracized and marginalized. Commentaries say she was probably never married or at least divorced. 12 years of no human touch. Sickness, suffering, that which tormented her was gone. No more bleeding, healed. But interestingly enough, the Greek here just indicates a physical healing. Now, I imagine she probably stood up, didn't want to be on the ground, a little bit straighter, and she was probably hightailing it out of there before she was found out. But just as instantly as she was healed, Jesus felt power go out from him. Now, I imagine he felt compassion, and actually, compassion is something that it talks about like a movement in your bowels. It's that what you feel in your stomach. I imagine he had that feeling, and not kind of like that lightning bolt, that goes between one person and another. Something stirred inside of him. This woman desperate. This woman who had internalized that which society had to say about her. You're bad, soiled, unclean, despised. You can't touch any man or you'll make him unclean. You have now contaminated Jesus. Despised. The degradation haunted her. It lived within her. It constantly, I was to say, like that tape, but now like the cassette, the CD, the MP3. Despised, unclean, unwanted. And so there, then, I've lost the right page. Oh, there it is. Okay, so with that, though, she wanted the healing. She wanted something, and she got it. So let the parade to Jairus' house continue. But Jesus wasn't content with letting this one who touched him, the one who exchanged illness and suffering for power, for healing. Jesus wasn't willing to let her just walk away with that something. Jesus wanted a personal encounter with someone. Jesus wanted to know that she was someone, that she had been seen and noticed, not forgotten, not despised. So he asks, "Who touched me? Who touched me?" The disciples, they thought that Jesus was crazy to ask that question. Remember, there were crowds pressing in against him. Surely they had bumped those germy elbows. No, surely they had bumped elbows. But there wasn't any healing power transferred from Jesus to them, because there was something different about pressing in and deliberately seeking the Savior, seeking the great physician, seeking the one who can make you well. Different from pressing in to seeking out, to reaching out, to touching Jesus with faith and believing that Jesus is one who can make you whole again. Who touched me? Jesus was waiting. He wasn't going to proceed to Jairus' house until he knew, until there was that personal encounter, until the one who touched him was more than physically cured, but made whole, reborn, a new creation, until the one who touched him was whole. It didn't matter, as callous as it may sound, it didn't matter that there was a 12-year-old girl knocking on death's door that he was headed towards. What mattered was that this woman had spent 12 years, 624 weeks, suffering. The word there for suffering, it's about torment, and it's about physical pain. It's no small thing. 12 years suffering, 624 weeks, with the only touch being abusive. She was in as much need as that little one. Who touched me? With fear and trembling, now she fell at Jesus' feet, prostrate, a position of worship, just like the demoniac, just like the leper. Fear and trembling, though, like what is going to happen? She knows that she should not have touched him. She knows that she has now made him unclean. What's he to do? Well, he listened to her. It's a piece of the story that I missed for a long time. It says that she came and fell to her knees. It's actually fell to her face. Fell to her face in front of him and told him what she had done. That sounds like she told him, "Well, I like crawled through the crowd and I touched the hem of your robe." Jesus already knew that. She told him her story. She told him about the 12 years, the 624 weeks of being ostracized, of being despised, of not having that good, appropriate, consensual, healing touch. He heard her. He listened to her. She was someone, not unclean. And he calls her daughter. While she doesn't get a name like, Susan or Mary, there's a lot of Marys, or Jane, she gets called daughter. She gets called the beloved of God. She is restored. She is reborn. She is welcome back into the community and can worship. The desire for healing and wholeness is a desire for Jesus, not just pressing in and bumping elbows, but seeking, risking, being desperate enough to take that risk and to just touch the hem of his garment, to have that faith that Jesus can heal. I got to turn to the page so I say it right. Again, healing isn't about you mounting up the right amount of faith. If your prayers aren't answered as you wanted them to be, whether through medical care, whether through the supernatural, if your prayers are going to be answered in the life to come, it's not that you don't have enough faith. It's not about having enough faith for God to heal. The burden for healing is not on you, is not on the sick. The burden for healing is on God, his wisdom and his mercy. And it's cruelty. It's cruelty to blame the sick for lack of faith. In fact, this man who has the gift of healing, he says that faith for healing is confidence in Jesus' ability to heal. And you can have and ought to pray with the confidence, assuming that healing will happen. And if it doesn't in the moment, it's okay. It's okay to say, I don't know why not, but we'll keep praying until God says stop, because he'll give you the grace to endure. This woman, Jesus is her only hope. She sought him out. She took the risk and she dared to touch him. Spiritually suffering, physically suffering, and emotionally suffering. Can you see yourself in that woman? I know, guys, it might be kind of hard, but can you see yourself in that woman? Is there something that you have been dealing with for 624 weeks, 12 years, 1 year, 2 days? Is there something that causes you to be desperate? Or are you desperate enough? It doesn't have to be a physical illness, but it can be. It can be those aches and pains. It can be that persistent cough. Or is it something deeper? Is it a sin that has taken root in your life? It doesn't always have to be a suffering. I can't find the way I want to say that. Sometimes what you're dealing with is unconfessed sin. It is unforgiveness. Sometimes what you are dealing with is the fact that you were the victimizer and not the victim. That you need to seek out that healing from God that will restore you to wholeness. But for you, your story might be one of abuse. Your story might be one of worry, of poverty. Your story might be one of rejection and isolation and being ostracized, being degraded. If only you reach out and touch the hem of Jesus' garment, you will be healed. She was confident in that. Are we confident in that? Do we have that hope? I think the bigger question is, are we desperate for healing? Do we want it? Are we willing to risk? So, there's all sorts of ways to go with this passage, but I think that is where I am going to I'd hate to say end. That's where I'm going to stop today. I'm going to stop with the question of, how are you like this woman? How are you suffering? What is it that has caused you to be hopeless? And are you desperate enough? Not just to press into Jesus, not just to bump elbows, but to seek him through prayer, to seek him through his word, to seek him through worship. Are you desperate? Are you confident that he wants to heal you? Not just cure you, but make you whole. He says to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace," a Hebrew blessing, shalom. That doesn't just mean like the absence of conflict. That means go and be whole. Live in God's presence. And he says then, "Your suffering is over." The Greek, guess what it is? It's the word used for salvation, for wholeness. Her healing is complete. Her faith has made her well. She's a person to Jesus. She's seen, she's heard, she's listened to. Jesus stopped to do that on his way to heal another person suffering. That's how much you matter. So, what is it? And are you willing to seek Jesus? Are you confident? Do you have the faith to bring it to his feet, to touch the hem of his garment? As we move towards communion, Sheila is going to sing, but we have prayer cards, and I think you all have a slide, but it's for the week, and I don't have them with me, but I'll make sure I have them available, all of the different ones. She's not like the others who prayed a prayer like, "Have mercy on me." So this is more of a means by which to give you confidence, the prayer. If I can just touch Jesus' robe, I will be healed. And then on the other side, what have you been dealing with for a long time or a short time? What is that situation, that illness, that suffering that has left you feeling hopeless? Have you reached out for Jesus? And have you told Jesus your whole story? Jesus knows it, but he wants us to share it with him. And so do it today and hear the words, "Beloved, beloved daughter, beloved son, go in peace. Your suffering is over." enough distance. So we're going to move to a time where we celebrate the blood of Christ's sacrifice. It would be all for naught for Jesus to step out of heaven, to put his infinite body into a finite human body. It'd be all for naught for him to have walked those dusty roads, all for naught for him to have sacrificed, to have been tortured, humiliated, mocked, hung on a cross, crucified, excruciating pain, his side pierced, all for naught, his resurrection, his ascension. If we can't put our confidence in him, if we can't place our faith in him, his ministry was one of healing. His ministry was one of setting the oppressed free. If it was important in the first century, it's certainly important now. That didn't go away. If nothing more, he said, you will go on to do far more greater things. He's equipped us to pray for one another. Nothing too dirty that Jesus can't make clean. Nothing in your past that the blood of Christ cannot cover, cannot heal, cannot forgive. If only you touch the hem of his robe, you shall be healed. We are going to experience the grace of Christ. We believe that his real presence, not his body and blood, but his real presence is in the bread and the cup. I invite those of you who are watching, who are here live on Zoom and Facebook, to also celebrate communion, something bread-like. And if you don't have wine, even though the United Methodist Church calls for abstinence from alcohol, and if you don't have grape juice or grape Kool-Aid, water would be a good option, the best option if you don't have the others. So, when we come to pass it out to you all, we do have the individual cups. Don't reach over them to grab the one on the other side. I will be giving you a piece of bread. Give me a big target, okay? I'm not going to drop it from like 3 feet or anything, so that I can give you the bread without touching. And so now I'm going to offer thanks to God and pray for the Holy Spirit to be amongst us. I'm going to remember my mask to start out with this. Whew, okay. Okay. So I can't go back that far. We're going to have to start like putting it over to the side, I think. So God, we do give you thanks and praise that you gave your all for us, that you did indeed wash us clean by demonstrating that at the Last Supper, by donning a towel and washing the feet of the one who would betray, the one who would deny, the one who would doubt, those that abandon, nothing too dirty that you cannot make clean. And then you took bread and you gave thanks and you broke it and you gave it to your disciples and you said, take, eat. This is my body broken for you, for your healing and wholeness. And when the supper was over, you took the cup, you gave thanks, and you said, this is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sin, to wash you clean, to make you whole, reborn, a new creation. Drink from this, all of you. So we pray, Holy Spirit, come upon us. Come upon all those who will be sharing in this meal as a community. Holy Spirit, come. And Holy Spirit, come upon these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, your presence, one with each other, one with you, and one in ministry, healing the sick, setting the prisoner free, lifting up the oppressed. We might be in ministry with you. All glory and power is yours. We look forward to that that heavenly banquet table where we are all gathered around as your beloved sons and daughters, not unclean, but washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Amen. Okay, we're going to see how good I am at putting gloves on again. Let's say Facebook and YouTube, I'm disconnecting us right now, but indeed, the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. Go and be healed. Okay, I don't have to smile now, I have the mask on.